Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our Operational Taxes virtual seminar. We hope you're well. Just again, a final reminder, anyone that's just recently, very recently joined the call, please ensure you're on mute and your cameras are turned off. During today's seminar, virtual seminar, we will be using Slido. So if you haven't already, either through your phone or through your laptop, please log in to slido.com with the hashtag OpsTax, because we'll be using that slightly later on for a couple of interactive questions. And also, if you want to ask any other questions as we go through the content, please feel free to use Slido as a means to pose those questions anonymously. Alternatively, there is a chat function within Teams if you're able to use that, and obviously there is no anonymity in that case, but if you want to raise any queries or anything jumps out at you, please feel free to use the chat function as well, and we'll aim to respond to obviously as many of your questions as possible before we close. In terms of timing today, we expect to run probably for about 35-40 minutes in terms of the content to allow some sufficient time for Q&A at the end, so we'll definitely be wrapped up before 11 o'clock. Thank you. So by way of introduction, I am Martin Killer. I lead our operational taxes business at Grant Thornton in the UK within our financial services business. And today I'm joined by Jasmine Chan, one of my colleagues and associate director, and Noble Chowdhury. And we all focus specifically around operational taxes for banks, insurers and asset managers. And we're glad to have you with us today. Just one other housekeeping point, obviously, other than Slido, we're still working from home, and obviously the recording is being made. So we do apologise in advance if there are any disruptions that are outside of our control. We hope we'll be able to make it through the call without too many disruptions. But thank you in advance for your understanding. So in terms of the content for today's seminar, there are three key areas or three key themes you want to delve into in a bit more detail. First of all, I'm going to give an update on what we perceive to be HMRC's, the tax transparency agenda, where it's evolved from and where it is heading to. And in particular, I think in underpinning all three of these areas, given the time available, we won't be able to go into all the technical details that I know we'd love to do at some juncture. But what we will do, what we really want to do is focus on what is changing, what's triggering that change, either from a tax authority or a legislative perspective, what impact that's likely to have on your own institutions and ultimately on potential customer and investor behaviour. And what are the key actions? What are the things you should be doing now or focusing on in order to address either the more imminent changes, which we're going to talk about, or things that we know are coming down the track over the next year or two? So I want to make it as informative as possible and ensure you are forewarned about those changes. So the transparency agenda we'll kick off with first, and that's, I say, focused on what's happened with HMRC and what is coming down the track in terms of particularly in the UK, what's in it being announced. Jasmine will then talk a bit about withholding tax risk and specific developments within the European Union and elsewhere, which are impacting particularly in the asset management industry. And then finally, I'll touch on a few developments coming down the track with respect to the Common Reporting Standard and the US Qualified Intermediary rules. So first of all, let me start with the HMRC transparency agenda. So we know HMRC, along with many other global tax authorities, have been focused and continue to be focused on this, have been focused for a number of years. And this slide really demonstrates, over the course of the last 10 years or so, the journey we've all been on in terms of understanding, the drive from HMRC in terms of their focus on really trying to understand, trying to get a better hold in terms of transparency, but create greater governance and greater compliance, particularly in the financial services industry, around tax compliance, and particularly around the interaction that institutions have with their customers and other stakeholders to ensure everyone is seen, is paying their fair share of tax. And with a great many things, as things have evolved over the last few years, more and more of these regimes and initiatives from HMRC have got an international angle to them, as we'll talk about in a number of areas in a moment. It's not just driven by perceptions around what is the right amount of tax to pay in the UK, but certainly through the interaction HMRC has with a number of tax treaty partners, it's now much more focused as well on the right amount of tax that customers of financial institutions are paying in different jurisdictions. And this whole area is something, you know, which obviously has had a lot of focus over the last few years. And I think in the current environment and coming out of the pandemic, it's something we would expect clearly more focus on over the next few years in light of, you know, budget deficits, but also in light of changes in general behaviour and trying to work out, you know, what is the right amount of tax that people should be subject to. So FATCA CRS obviously was a starting point for a large, FATCA was a large part of the starting point of a lot of this over 10 years ago now from the US. But since then, the OECD, as well as a number of tax authorities, have been instrumental in driving forward the common reporting standard. We'll talk about some of the particular changes later on. But I think that is really, that was the game changer for a lot of these other initiatives that came following that, which have really tried to focus on tax behaviour, good conduct, and as I said, the focus on transparency and ensuring people are paying the right amount of tax. The corporate criminal offence rules in the UK, which came in 4 years ago, we're going to talk about where things currently stand in a moment. But again, that was an instrumental regime from HMRC's perspective in terms of really focusing on the conduct of corporate bodies to ensure there is a level of governance and reasonable procedures around understanding what their staff and their other stakeholders were doing in the context of managing people's tax positions, and in particular thinking about the risks around where people may be seen or could potentially help others evade tax. Beneficial ownership registers obviously have been around again for a number of years. The UK and other taxes and other authorities have really grown the gamut of understanding where privately held companies, trusts and other types of vehicles now are required to disclose information on their beneficial owners, both in the UK and elsewhere. Some of those registers are obviously public, and there's still an ongoing debate around how much further those kinds of registers will develop in time. The requirement to correct legislation in 2018 was perhaps a one-off exercise, at least at the time, from HMRC to enable UK tax residents to update their historic tax affairs, particularly in relation to overseas income. But again, there was a reasonable amount of interaction back in 2018 when those rules were, or when that period was running, for financial institutions to ensure their, first of all, their customers were aware of the potential for amending tax returns, but also, you know, what were the potential downfalls of not responding within the particular window HMRC set. And I think that does lay a trail for some of the stuff we're going to talk about that's coming down the track in the next year or so. Obviously, OECD mandatory disclosure rules were announced a year or two ago, and in the UK we now have obviously a very limited form of DAC 6, which will evolve into the OECD mandatory disclosure rules we expect over the next year or two. But again, with that focus on tax evasion, particularly in the hallmarks that currently exist in the UK, there's very much a linkage into some of these other regimes and the whole transparency debate. So I do see some quite a lot of alignment now with where the UK is heading with those, with the MDR rules as they currently set. And finally, financial institution notices, a new bit of legislation which is likely to hit the statute book in the next few months. We'll talk about it in a bit more detail, but that is again very much a focus from HMRC's perspective on responding, they would say, responding to a large number of requests they receive from overseas tax authorities as a result of CRS information exchange. But in addition, it's another indication of the amount of, power, but the amount of influence HMRC will have around obtaining information from financial institutions in particular on data that's been shared with them with respect to their customers. And again, coming out in the current scenario, in the current situation, we can see much more activity from HMRC asking questions about customers of institutions going forwards. So we just move on now to the corporate criminal offence. So obviously, as I said, these rules have been around for best part of 4 years nearly. I think it's fair to say whenever we run these seminars or we have these events, we often talk about the state of play in terms of implementation. And I think it never surprises me, there are still a reasonable number of people in the market who, whilst probably aware of these rules to a degree, maybe haven't taken the level of steps which HMRC may have envisaged they would have taken by this stage. I guess just in terms of some of the messages here, I think it's fair to say HMRC always saw this legislation as, you know, not necessarily as a primary means of just prosecuting people for not having procedures in place, but was very much a focus on ensuring good governance and conduct in the business to try and prevent tax evasion happening in the first place. So very much seen as a preventative regime as much as anything else. As I said, the rules have always been in place now for nearly 4 years. There is no formal reporting mechanism, which again probably plays back into the realms of where some people perhaps haven't done as much as they should have done or could do in the immediate future, because there is no immediate reporting obligation to HMRC. There is really just the means to demonstrate that you've got reasonable procedures in place to defend yourselves if the company was ever charged with the particular offence. But clearly, you know, as you say here, ignorance is no defence in itself. Everyone, whether large, small, or whatever, there are no financial thresholds to these rules, has to play their part. We seem to be playing their part in terms of implementing the rules as envisaged, and clearly commensurately to the risk and everything else they've undertaken to identify the risks of the legislation applying in their business, making sure the procedures are consistent with the risks identified. And in terms of the current position, again, these figures, you know, from a few months back, but we are still of the view HMRC have a number of live investigations going on in the UK, going across a number of different industries, but in particular there are several that impact on financial institutions, and there are a number of other cases which are under review and could lead to similar investigations coming through. I think it's also fair to say what's also driving HMRC behaviour, or will drive HMRC behaviour over the coming months and years in this space, is their international activities. So the J5, the amalgamation of the five tax authority jurisdictions, including the UK, to try and clamp down on tax evasion and harmful practices, is definitely informing HMRC's view of the types of activities they need to focus on. And therefore, when they're asking questions of companies, and in particular financial institutions, how have they demonstrated their compliance with these rules? Definitely they are using the knowledge gained from their overseas partners in terms of training those questions for inspectors to ask of institutions. And obviously for those companies and institutions which are large and are subject to have a CRM with HMRC and are subject to the BRR plus regime, we know whilst there have been perhaps more limited interactions with HMRC over the last year due to the pandemic going forwards, we know HMRC are placing a lot of interest in BRR plus and in terms of interrogating information, and certainly the outcome of any questions and reviews around CCO will have a significant bearing on how institutions' risk ratings are assessed currently in the light of BRR plus. So very much HMRC are on the front foot here, ready to to challenge institutions on what they've done, and ready to use the powers they have within the rules to seek to apply them as appropriately. Very quickly as a recap, I won't go through this in detail, but obviously under the CCO rules, there are two offences effectively. The first one, the UK tax evasion offence, I'm sure most people are familiar with, obviously it applies across the gamut of all companies and partnerships, regardless of where they are located, and links to an act of UK criminal tax evasion that's taken place. The focus here from an institutional perspective is around identifying those associated persons of the company who could be facilitating tax evasion whilst performing services on behalf of the financial institution. And the definition of associated persons we know is very broad, including employees, contractors, but other providers of services or other outsource agents who will undertake services on behalf of a financial institution are likely to be caught by the associated person definition. And therefore, the risk assessments undertaken need to cover off that full gamut of associated persons. And finally, the statutory defence there, obviously, even if tax evasion has taken place, if the institution can demonstrate it has implemented reasonable procedures, then that may be or should be a reasonable defence to argue to avoid the imposition of a potential fine or other form of levy by HMRC in accordance with the legislation. There obviously is the potential to demonstrate that it wasn't reasonable to implement, or sorry, that you weren't required to implement reasonable procedures. But I do think, particularly in the financial services industry, it's a very hard task to demonstrate that what you have in place already would be sufficient to argue there wasn't a need to implement additional processes for CCO. In terms of that equivalent offence under foreign law, I think it's fair to say, you know, talking to clients and institutions generally, that's probably an area where there's been perhaps less focus. for those entities that have undertaken risk assessments, probably a large part is focused on UK activities and where the risk of UK evasion could arise. But certainly HMRC, to date, I would say the investigations, what we know from HMRC's activities, have to a certain degree focused on UK tax evasion and following the trail back to institutions and other companies to assess how the CCO has been implemented. But I think with that interaction with the J5 community and with other tax authorities generally, there will be an increasing focus on overseas tax evasion or the second leg of the offence in due course. So it's important to ensure those reasonable procedures do cover the overseas offence as well. So just move on to our first Slido question. So if you haven't logged in already, please do to slido.com, hashtag OpsTax. So our first question, to the extent to which your organisation has implemented reasonable procedures to comply with the CCO rules, how often are those procedures reviewed? So four potential answers there. Obviously, whether you'd undertake it annually as part of a general review of other policies, or perhaps more frequently, because it's a high risk area or for whatever other reason, or maybe you review them on an as needs basis. Or finally, if you haven't implemented reasonable procedures, feel free to answer to the fourth point, because it's not applicable. We'll give that a moment to run through the analysis, and then we'll give some results. Okay, I think we'll probably call it there, may move around, fluctuate a bit, but clearly we're seeing a significant majority of people saying they understand there's an annual assessment of the policies, I presume in line with other reviews of other policies, whether it's linked to internal audit or other internal governance matters, which is interesting. But certainly the one that stands out is the third response, where people have not implemented reasonable procedures yet. And I think for those, it'd be useful to know, obviously, where you think your organisation is in terms of the process for complying with these rules, whether risk assessment hasn't undertaken and you've not decided to implement any other procedures, or whether there are still gaps, because certainly, as we say, the HMRC are asking more questions around this area now. But I think as part of the overall reasonableness, having a policy or something that demonstrates the ongoing, which we'll talk about in a moment, the ongoing monitoring of the reasonable procedures is clearly a part of the compliance requirements set out under the rules. So therefore, even if you're in the as needs basis response for undertaking those reviews, again, it's worth understanding how formal still those reviews will be undertaken, and whether that will be seen to be reasonable in the context of the changes to your ongoing business and use of personnel and structuring, as to whether or not that is reasonable. So I think all of those latter responses in terms of as needs or having not implemented procedures should be reviewed. So thanks very much for that. And then finally, just as the takeaway for CCO, really, I wanted to focus on just a little bit on, well, I see quick wins, particularly for those institutions that, you know, say may have started implementing reasonable procedures or still sort of deciding where the best place is to go with this. So let's assume, obviously, the risk assessment has been undertaken. As envisaged, the revenue would expect, as a result of the risk assessment having been undertaken and thinking about specific risk of facilitation of evasion taking place with different types of associated person, it's really focusing on the types of controls and procedures and policies that should be implemented commensurate with the risks that were identified. So we would say, you know, from our perspective and having worked with a large number of organisations, if the risk of a particular type of associated person conducting or being able to facilitate tax evasion risk is low, then the proportionate response to that may be there is limited need for a new procedure other than tightening up on existing AML bribery or corruption type processes, which perhaps overlap with the risk of wider financial crime like tax evasion taking place. But where a risk assessment either is not conclusive on risk, or it is perceived the risk is higher, associated persons could potentially evade risk, even if ultimately one would think the risk is still fairly low, then a reasonable person would expect there to be additional controls and new procedures put in place. I think in terms of the quick wins, we talked about a lot of institutions have used, rather than necessarily going back to the starting board and trying to create brand new procedures, having a specific policy around CCO and around the institution's obviously view, but the way they govern the risk of tax evasion in the organisation, certainly having policies is has been seen to be perhaps a quicker win. It's something that could be applied across an organisation or maybe across different business units in different ways. Can obviously be linked into training requirements, but provides a more of a snapshot and something that can be updated or amended on a perhaps more easy basis as things change. And again, implementing checklists, whether it's in terms of due diligence for new suppliers or outsourcers of services, providing creating standardized checklists again and using standardized terminology and checks around tax evasion and other people's views of tax evasion, again, potentially is a quicker win than perhaps going back and creating brand new policies. And again, key is communication. Again, whether it's updating existing agreements you have with outsource or other service providers, or thinking about you know, what communication's happening internally, again, getting those out messages out is key. And finally, links to whistleblowing and escalation. Obviously, there is a equivalent of a whistleblowing type process the HMRC announced a number of years ago in connection with CCO, which everyone should take account of, and that in itself should be factored into your reasonable procedures. But again, linking it to existing procedures around financial crime is something most people would have done rather than necessarily creating a brand new process for addressing the CCO risk on its in itself. Training, again, a quick win, something expectation-wise HMRC would expect obviously all organisations to undertake in some degree or form. A lot of institutions obviously have undertaken or set out either e-learning modules or things that are bolted on to existing AML type training manuals. And again, that is typically seen to be a reasonable element of approach on the training side. But I think in certain areas of the business, particularly when you look at financial people in compliance, financial crime, those that are typically charged with monitoring the progress of the legislation, there may be a need for additional training, not only for those individuals to understand obviously what the rules mean in practice, but equally to how to deal with those specific cases that arise within the institution, whether it's through whistleblowing or typical alerts which come from other people, or dealing with actual live cases. So again, there may be a need for additional training there. And everything clearly referenced back to HMRC principles as set out. And finally, in terms of monitoring, I know a large number of organisations will be in this mode now, as we've seen. You know, there obviously are regular touch points now for people to monitor. But it is crucial, I think, still at this stage, that there is an involvement by senior management, even in the monitoring process, as much as there was at the start of the programme where risk assessments were undertaken. And ongoing monitoring is clearly essential to demonstrating reasonable procedures are in place. There's no point in having created something and not then checking it on a reasonably regular basis. But also checking the underlying assumptions. Obviously, over the course of the last 3 years, there will have been changes, some to the AML regulations, for example, they have evolved. But equally, there'll be changes in some of the practices the businesses have undertaken, whether it's in terms of who services are outsourced to, the countries through which services are provided, or just different ways of contracting or using different people engaged for different services. So again, that needs to be highlighted as part of the monitoring to ensure procedures are valid. And finally, as is obvious, more obvious points in the financial institution industry, the reviewing of the sanctions listed countries is clearly relevant, and the location of associated persons in the light of what's happened with the pandemic is clearly important, because again, over time, people may have changed locations. So that's everything I wanted to say on CCO. Apologies, I need to follow up on time. So the final area I wanted to pick up on in terms of transparency was the financial institution notices legislation. So this is amendments to the Schedule 36 of FA 2008. We have legislation in the finance bill, which is likely obviously to receive royal assent in the next 2 or 3 months. And ultimately what these rules provide for is enhanced HMRC information powers to ask financial institutions for information in relation to their underlying clients or investors. The primary change result of these rules is to enable HMRC to issue notices without a requirement to get a tribunal approval. Because in the past, HMRC have felt this has taken a significant amount of time to slowing up the process to get tribunal approvals and to ultimately get information in order to either for HMRC's own purposes or to serve a notice that they received from an overseas tax authority where information has been shared under the common reporting standards. So HMRC would say this is viewed as bringing us online with consistency with other jurisdictions where they don't have an equivalent tribunal process. So one would envisage there will be an increased level of inquiries issued by HMRC once the rules go live, in order to pick up any of the detail that's not been, they've not been able to serve previously. It's important to mention there's no right, automatic right of appeal by an institution to a notice being served on it. Clearly, if they are penalised subsequently, there's obviously a means of appealing against any fines or other levies that the HMRC may serve. But fundamentally, if a notice is served, then you are required to potentially, well, to respond to it. So therefore, in terms of the key actions, the gamut of financial institution is very broad. Anyone caught by CRS, broadly speaking, is in scope with a few limited exceptions. Key actions, I think, here are to develop, if not already, for other means, purposes, to develop policies for how you respond to these requests. It's likely to be a 30-day turnaround. Obviously, there will likely be involvement potentially with the underlying customers in order to confirm what data you have on them and what can be provided. But obviously, in terms of the detail of what's in the notice, you'll need to be clear around what information is in your remit, what you're able to provide, both technically and what clearly relates to the notice itself. And therefore, early engagement with stakeholders is key. I include HMRC there because I think clearly, notwithstanding there's no immediate right of appeal to the notice, there's possible need, maybe a need for dialogue with HMRC depending on the level of information required under the notice to see whether it's possible to negotiate, get an extension of time, or potentially try and refocus the inquiry if you feel some of the questions are just either not relevant or difficult to answer. You may find there is a need to speak to HMRC. And finally, for clearly, in terms of the data that's picked up as part of the notice, it may be a need for you to go back, obviously, and check the validity of what's been reported on under CRS previously, and ultimately think about whether what's been collected initially is valid and correct, and therefore the underlying procedures may need to be reviewed. I think here, particularly in this like a private wealth space where you've got trusts and other managed vehicles which have been classified in a certain way, that information clearly and how that's been reported on and through HMRC may have a bearing on some of these notices, and therefore how clients have been classified could come back to be have to be revisited. And equally, in the more extreme cases, potentially where there is a risk of someone being claimed, a tax evasion may claim to have taken place overseas, there may not be a requirement, or you may not be able to disclose information to the underlying customer, but you may wish to look back or think about, you know, some of the other procedures you put in place around CCO and the risk assessment in order to address that. One thing I would say is, whilst we expect the rules to go live in the next couple of months, I would envisage there will be a need for more guidance to be provided to institutions, particularly perhaps at a sectorial level, a bit like there was for CCO, to ensure a level playing field in terms of when these notices are issued, to ensure, you know, there's a common approach or understanding applied across the industry. So one would hope more guidance will be provided in due course. So with that, I will now hand over to Jasmine. Thank you.
Thanks, Martin. So today I'll be talking about how you could potentially manage your withholding tax risk in respect of your investments that you might have globally, and also touching on some developments and trends that we're seeing in the market. So on the next slide, I've summarised some of the kind of topics I'll be touching on today. But what I wanted to start off with actually is taking a step back and having a think about how you manage your risk and kind of the governance system that you have in place. I wanted to start off with a question on Slido with the poll. So essentially what this question is looking at is how well you manage your risk. So the first option here is where you have really good knowledge of your tax status across all of your investment jurisdictions. And so essentially you're maximising relief at source where you know that's available and it can be offered, and you've done all the documentation and you're reclaiming at every available opportunity considering the cost benefit analysis. And the second and third options are likely to be the ones that most people will fall under, and essentially where you've got a custodian that's offering a tax service and that's all you're currently reclaiming. It's dependent on what they offer and you're not going outside of that. And the last one is where nothing is essentially done, and you treat the tax that you might suffer as a result of the investment as part of like a sunk cost of doing business. So just give everyone a few minutes to see where we are with that. Okay, so it looks like with the large majority, most people are comfortable with what they're doing, but it is very dependent on the custodian. So that's actually in line with what we see in the market, and is in line with a large number of what our clients have. So if your custodian offers that tax service, which typically is in more well-established jurisdictions, then you're maximising the tax position in respect of those jurisdictions. Where the market is a little bit more difficult, and you typically see that in LATAM and in the APAC regions, then that's where you might see some tax leakage, because that's typically areas or jurisdictions that the custodian are less likely to offer a tax service, purely because of the complexity of these types of claims in those jurisdictions. So that's very much in line with what we would expect. So thank you for everyone for participating in that. As you can probably guess, the first one is probably the best option to fall under, which is where you've got a really good system and you're maximising everything where possible. So on the next slide, I'll summarise essentially a snapshot of what we would expect if you had a really good system and you essentially selected option one in the Slido previously. So this is where you've got a governance system in place, you're managing all of your rates, you're aware of what's changed, and you're monitoring all of that, whether or not it's through an internal mechanism or through kind of your network and the external advisors that you've got. So most withholding tax changes are typically effective from 1st of Jan every year. So what we typically see is a flurry of activity in Q1, where you would look at what has happened and what changes have applied, what that means for you as a business, and therefore what sort of tax documentation should I need to put in place to make sure that I'm reducing the tax leakage. What's important to bear in mind, though, is that even though changes are typically effective from 1st of Jan each year, that's not always the case. So you do need to have that kind of wider mechanism and control mechanism in place to make sure that you're capturing all of the changes where possible. And once you've done that and you've got all the documentation in place, in theory and dependent on the market, you should be able to maximise relief at source, and therefore you've got that cash flow benefit, because as you are probably all aware, reclaims can be very problematic and painful at times depending on the jurisdiction, and sometimes processing times can be really lengthy as well, so that can obviously add to the cash flow impact. So all in all, this is what we would expect if you had a good process in place. And one thing I really wanted to touch on really briefly is Brexit is obviously one of the things that has impacted withholding tax rates and how that could impact your business. So if you had a good system in place, we would expect that that would have been captured and monitored as part of the first phase, the first box here, and then you would move through these different boxes to make sure that essentially at the end of it, you have either maximised relief at source or you've reclaimed anything where you haven't had the documentation in place in time. So one of the key Brexit changes that I'll touch upon briefly is the interest and royalty directive payments. And so previously, payments of that sort of manner would have been exempt by virtue of that directive. Now, as a result of Brexit, as of 1st of Jan 2021, that directive obviously no longer applies. And so the default 20% rate should apply to payments made on or after 1st of June 2021, with some certain nuances depending on the specific circumstances that we're looking at for you. But the good news is that the UK does have a large treaty network. So if the removal of the directive does impact your business, one of the things, if you did have a good governance system in place, is you would consider what relief is available, whether or not that's via treaty or another mechanism, and you'd get the relevant approvals in place where that's required. So if it is a treaty position that would get you down from the 20% rate, you'd want to make sure that you've got the relevant approvals from HMRC as soon as possible, because processing times can take anywhere from 1 to 3 months to process, depending on the complexity of the case and how busy HMRC are. So I say 1 to 3, typically it's more 1 to 2, but we have seen instances where it's crept closer to the 3-month mark. And another thing to note is once you get that treaty direction, is making sure you make a note of that expiry date, because it's not for life. So you need to make sure that that is monitored. So this again links back to your controls and your governance that you've got in place. And that's not just in respect of the treaty directions issued by HMRC. That could be in respect of other things, the documentation you give to your custodian, the status of your reclaims. It's monitoring that to make sure that you can continue to reduce your tax leakage, even when you're stripping out the fact that rates can continue to change. In a static kind of world, you're monitoring what you've currently got, your current exposure. So that was what I wanted to talk about really briefly in terms of the governance process. If you have any specific questions in terms of how that could impact you, reach out to us after the webinar. We're more than happy to discuss that with you in a little bit more detail. So on this slide, I want to talk briefly about TRACE, which again is another market trend that we are seeing in the market. So TRACE is essentially started off as an OECD initiative, and it stands for Treaty Relief and Compliance Enhancement. And Finland is actually the first country to have adopted this, with it being effective from 1st of January this year. And in practical terms, the application of TRACE is very similar actually to the US's Qualified Intermediary QI system, with the three elements that I've outlined on this slide being very similar to the factors that we would see in a QI regime. So what I have then outlined in the next slide is a very brief example of how TRACE might work in practice. So on this slide, I wanted to highlight kind of the different roles that people under the TRACE model would have. So TRACE has the concept of an AI, which stands for Authorised Intermediary. And this is the entity which is typically a custodian or another intermediary who has agreed with the Finnish tax authorities to take on the responsibilities of obtaining and reviewing the documentation that they get from the investors or the beneficial owner, and then instructing the withholding agent to apply the relevant withholding tax rates. AIs as part of the TRACE model are essentially the ones that are liable for any tax should there be any under withholding. So from the tax authority's perspective, if there is any under withholding, they would go to the AI for that. And the way it would work, as I've touched upon on the left, is you have the AI requesting the investors for that self-declaration form. Now, the benefit of TRACE and the idea behind it is it's meant to simplify the process, both from the AI's perspective and from the investor's perspective. So the investor has a standardised self-declaration documentation they need to complete, which essentially confirms their tax status and potentially the reductions in tax rate that they may be entitled to, whether or not it's due to treaty rates. And from the AI's perspective, they've got a standard form that they then receive back and they can then review and make sure that they're happy with. So it's simplifying the process for both parties. And like I mentioned earlier, subject to that, and once they're happy with it, they will then pass that information over to the withholding agent to apply the relevant rate. That's in a very, very simplified model. And on the right hand side, I just wanted to throw in that not all intermediaries will want to be an AI or meet the conditions to be an AI. So in these instances, they will be known as what is known under TRACE as a CI, which is a contractual intermediary. So CIs are very similar in concept to the NQI status under the US QI regime. And on the right, like I mentioned here, I've summarised how that would work in practice if you had a CI that's slotted in the payment chain. So in this scenario on the right, what would happen is from the investor's perspective, it's exactly the same. They do that standardised documentation and they provide it to the CI. The CI, however, because they are not an AI, they are required to pass that information up to the AI along with the tax pool information. And then similar to on the left, the AI does the same thing, then review the documentation. Once they're happy with that, they then pass that up to the information up to the withholding agent, so then they can then apply the relevant rates. So taking a step back from all of this, and what that means is we're seeing a trend in the market in terms of trying to simplify the process of relief at source. It's been going on for a number of years. Like I mentioned, OECD have talked about this for a number of years, and Finland's the first one to apply this. So what we are aware of is that other countries are monitoring how Finland have adopted TRACE and how successful it is. And in the near future, we might see other countries applying something very similar. So you might see a benefit from the investor's perspective where they might have standardised processes, but then it would put the onus on those that are registered as an AI or an AI equivalent to have that responsibility to look at the documentation and apply the relevant rates. And one final thing to note on TRACE is one of the factors that were included in the OECD's TRACE concept and initiative was the idea to have independent reviews to monitor how well the TRACE initiative is going and how well the AI is conducting its role. Now, this wasn't implemented by Finland, but that doesn't mean that that's not going to change in the future, because they might want to check, once people are comfortable with TRACE, that that people are doing what they should under the AI model. And also, any other country that adopts TRACE in the future, they may have this as a requirement at the onset, because they may take the view that people are now a little bit more comfortable with the TRACE model as they're not the first country to implement this. Okay. So on the next slide, I wanted to touch finally on some focus bank claims that we've got. So what I've summarised here is some developments that we've seen in the market. There has been a lot of activity in regards to focus bank claims over the last 6 to 12 months. There's a number of cases that have come through, some positive and some negative, for investments and funds. And I wanted to broadly highlight some of these for you here. In case anyone doesn't know what a focus bank claim is, essentially this is where the claimant, who could be an investor, argues that they're suffering a higher rate of withholding tax compared to an equivalent domestic investor, and therefore it goes against free movement of capital. And so a lot of work needs to be done if you want to do focus bank claims in terms of comparability tests to check that, number one, you are you can be compared to an equivalent domestic investor. And then where there is that disparity, you have the argument to potentially say, I'm due a reclaim. So some of the developments that I've noted on this slide, one of which is Spain. So there's been actually a number of positive cases for sovereign wealth funds or entities linked or controlled by a sovereign state to get full reclaim in Spain. So this is essentially where you've got a potentially a Canadian or a Norwegian sovereign wealth fund or similar, and they are comparable to a Spanish entity that is similarly linked to the Spanish government. And in those cases, those rates differ. So positive cases have been held in respect to both EU claims and third country claims, and non-EU ones as well. So dependent on the facts position, this might be something worth exploring. Secondly, we've also got the Netherlands. So on the flip side, we have some positive news, but we also have some not so good news. So very recently with the Netherlands, the Dutch Supreme Court decided that foreign investment funds are not entitled to reclaims. So on a very simplified level, is the basis for that ruling was that as of 2008 onwards, the treatment for Dutch investment funds, which could benefit from a remittance basis while foreign investment funds could not, was due to disparity in the tax system in which the country of the investment fund is based, as opposed to the kind of pure comparability test that's normally done under focus bank claims. And because the differences were due to that factor, that isn't considered going against the free movement of capital. So that was a negative position that came out of Netherlands, unfortunately. So obviously that is very new, so there it could change, but the latest position is not that favourable for some foreign investment funds investing in Netherlands. And finally, the one I wanted to touch on really briefly, again, which is very recent, is in regards to France. So the European Commission recently stated that France should amend their withholding tax rules in respect of the taxes that are charged by French companies to overseas life insurance companies, because it was contrary to the free movement of capital. So again, on a very simplified level, the basis for this was because the dividends that are paid to French life companies are not subject to withholding tax, but if it was paid to an overseas life insurance company, it would be there would be some withholding tax charged on that. So that was the main basis for why it was contrary to the free movement of capital. Now, it's just a recommendation by the European Commission. So France now has an opportunity to respond to the European Commission's recommendation And depending on the outcome of that, there is a potential reclaim opportunity if maybe France agrees and decides to change their rules, or it could be an argument going down, which could take a few more years to finally surface. So depending on the outcome of that and your level of investment in France and your status, it's worth just monitoring this as well, because there could be a potential reclaim opportunity for life insurance companies that invest in France. So that was all I wanted to talk about today. So I'll now hand back to Martin.
Thanks. Thank you, Jasmine. So moving on to the final section today, talking about the developments in CRS and qualified intermediary. Conscious of the time, so I won't labour too many points, but I want to get across to say what the main changes are coming down the track. Just moved. So in terms of CRS first, obviously I said before at the outset, the OECD obviously drove a lot of the initial CRS, development of CRS rules initially forward. Obviously HMRC were closely involved, but the OECD were very much the instigators of CRS and in terms of the terminology and where it got to. So in terms of recent developments, there were two OECD reports released at the end of last year. The first one was a peer review of all countries that have implemented the CRS since the get-go. And a rating was assessed, was attributed to all of the countries, depending on the OECD's view of how well they had implemented the rules as envisaged under the standard, but also, you know, how robust and how well the OECD considered the countries were policing the rules as it stood at the time. So a number of results came out of that, and I think it's fair to say, you know, whilst the UK got a reasonably clean bill of health, there were a number of countries, not all just purely developing ones, but a number of countries did get a warning shot that they needed to either tighten up their rules, perhaps where they were perhaps giving too many exemptions to certain types of vehicle, or they weren't, or the governments or tax authorities weren't necessarily applying enough suitable audit or pressure on financial institutions to ensure effective compliance. So that's one area, and that's certainly driving out certain changes, which we'll talk about in a moment. The other one was a compliance guide, as they call it, so promoting and assessing compliance. The top right hand box there was the second report the OECD released, again primarily driven from the perspective of the OECD advising governments and tax authorities on how they needed to create effective governance frameworks to assess the compliance of institutions in their jurisdiction. So for example, things like how you would undertake an audit, the kind of checklists and that kind of risk-based approach you'd need to apply to assess governance. And again, from a UK standpoint, perhaps less surprises given where HMRC are at already. But still, a number of interesting points covered in the report, which do shed the light on where things are likely to head in the future with respect to CRS. And certainly a lot of talk there around analysis of data, audits, and more direct reviews undertaken by tax authorities going forward were talked about in there. There's also some useful information there. I think that banks and insurers and asset managers, for example, can also draw on from the perspective of getting some comfort that what they're doing at the moment is compliant within the spirit of the rules. But in addition, if they consider there are potential gaps in their processes, there's again useful information there to be drawn on. So as a result of all that, we know that the OECD are going to be consulting probably later this year in terms of changes to the CRS. One is to pick up on developments in the industry generally that have occurred in the last 5-6 years since CRS started, where, you know, crypto assets, digital wallets, other kinds of financial fintech providers weren't really around when CRS started got going, and therefore they need to tighten up the rule, expand the scope of the rules to ensure a number of those different types of institutions are covered. But equally, the way in which services are delivered in a digital format, I think the OECD are also conscious of the fact that the basic rules around how you onboard customers needs to be updated to reflect the different ways in which channels in which existing or more traditional financial institutions are now securing business, whether it's across banking, asset management or insurance. Once that consultation is undertaken by the OECD, obviously there will be a period of response, and then tax authorities will need to then obviously be linked into that, ultimately for then local rules to be driven out. So I'd expect over the next year or two, there'll be changes to the standard itself, which will then need to be implemented domestically as there were last time around. So the actual changes to CRS may not come through for another 2 to 3 years as suggested here, possibly slightly longer, depending on the scale of the changes envisaged, but certainly changes afoot there. And equally, moving on, the definitions of some of the more difficult areas of reporting around controlling persons, for example, we expect there will be changes to how controlling persons are reported in the next few years to get more granular information on the types of controlling persons involved. And then the OECD mandatory disclosure rules, again, another area the OECD have put a lot of focus in, and we'd expect a broader expansion again of those rules, or certainly in terms of the scale of countries that sign up to them, particularly with the links back to CRS avoidance and obscuring beneficial ownership, which again links in, I think, fairly neatly to CRS, developments of CRS generally, and obviously tightening up on CRS rules themselves. So the OECD very much in the driving seat to effect some of those changes immediately. If we move on then to the next page around reporting generally, and some of this stuff is either happening already or is, I think, likely to happen as a result of some of those OECD announcements I talked about. So in terms of general reporting for this year or in respect of last calendar year, other than a couple of countries that have mentioned extensions already, we're not expecting any wholesale extensions of filing deadlines like there were last year as a result of COVID. So again, focus should be certainly on making sure the deadlines are met as quickly as possible. In terms of the data required for reporting, I mean, there's been a lot of focus around US TINs. Certainly HMRC, through instruction with the IRS, have now got a, not a mandatory, but an optional means for disclosing information on reasons why US TINs are not provided on FACA reports when submitted. And other countries, again, have followed suit. Jersey, at one point, were going to mandate changes to incorporate reasons for US TINs not being incorporated. I think that's now been backtracked slightly, but you can see the inference from the IRS around tightening up the rules for where there is missing data and the reasons for why that data has not been provided. So there's definitely more to be done around assessing, you know, gaps in the reporting data. And the perennial debate in the UK, particularly around the suspected indicia and the reasons for reporting a client or a customer for FATCA where there is where there's no self-certification or where there's lack of information on the identity of the individual versus just reporting positive indicia for CRS, is again flowing through into from the IRS perspective into why there are perhaps a large number of accounts being reportable for FATCA where there's no immediate US indicia, but because of the way the mechanical rules work, people are reporting them, and whether those rules would evolve over the next year or two again. The use of nil returns obviously is a bit sporadic across different countries, but again, coming out of that OECD report, there's definitely an inference that nil returns should be used as a means for testing compliance in jurisdictions to ensure everyone is doing what they should be doing, and therefore a nil return is seen as some kind of, you know, positive affirmation that you've done what you need to do and determined that you have no actual reporting, as opposed to it just being a paper exercise just to fill it in. And perhaps critically now, we're seeing more countries take on the slant that Cayman Islands and Luxembourg initially took last year around separate certification, around having FATCA and CRS compliance procedures in place. So whilst clearly in the UK it's always been expected you would have a compliance procedure to determine your compliance responsibilities of FATCA, there are now separate certification requirements, a bit akin to what happens in the US for QI, to ensure that responsible officers or in organisations are definitely ensuring those procedures are in place and they are being tested. Australia have recently come out also and said they're going to introduce similar rules. I would envisage, following on from those OECD peer reports, again, that's another area that will get more focus over the coming years. And finally, the use of information by tax authorities, we touched on already in terms of the FIN rules that are coming out in the UK, but we expect more interaction with tax authorities around, from the information exchanges, around information gaps and around ensuring, you know, quality of data. QI, I know a number of people on the call will be qualified intermediaries. So obviously this year is a big year for a number of QIs having to certify to the IRS on a three-yearly basis. Just to alert people who are not aware, there were some extensions recently announced by the IRS for certifications that were due during the course of this calendar year. So the 1 July deadline has been pushed out to 1 December, and the main deadline at the end of this year has been pushed out to 1st of March. So allows a bit more time to complete periodic certifications, obviously, as well as undertaking certain reviews and any remediation that's required. There's clearly still not a big time frame in order to get everything done by the required deadline, but the IRS have at least pushed those out consistent with the last round of certifications. But I think it's still fair to say, and we're seeing with the number of institutions we deal with, a lot of work still being done by the IRS on the prior certifications made in the last round in 2018 and 19. So the question of when the IRS will get around to reviewing the latest ones is to be seen. And still quite a lot of detail around the data itself still being churned over in terms of reporting reconciliations. We also know the QI agreement as it currently stands, the 2017 one, is due to be renewed, well, to be updated for 2023. In terms of expectations, I think obviously we know We'll talk about 1446 in a moment briefly, but we know 871M will likely come back on the agenda in terms of the broadening of scope of that in 2023. That will factor heavily in the QI agreement. But also I think in terms of onboarding and perhaps some of these other changes around CRS and the use of different material and information for onboarding, we could see some more linkages between QI and the FACC CRS regimes going forward into that next agreement. I know there's a lot of discussion at the moment in the US, particularly around the use of electronic documentation, whether it's in terms of the actual W8 documentation, but also in terms of holding certificates and the whole reporting process. So again, I could see more linkages into how that will be done in a more digital fashion, and that how that will be factored into the QI agreement will be interesting to see over the course of the next year or so. And finally, I just wanted to touch on the changes to the 1446F regs in the US. Again, I can't in 2 minutes give any sense of detail around what are the underpinning details to this. But broadly speaking, from a QI perspective, for any QIs which hold interests in US publicly traded partnerships, the underlying US regulations that deal with withholding on the sale or disposition of interests in those partnerships by non-US residents is an area which has been subject to much debate over the last few years, but the IRS regulations have now been finalised. As of 1st of January 2022, there will be a requirement for withholding to be due where, generally speaking, where non-US residents sell their interests in these publicly traded partnerships. Under the general US rules, typically the transferee or the person acquiring the interest will be subject to or required to withhold tax on the payments when they make them to the seller of the interest. But for publicly traded partnerships, the default position typically will be on the broker that's affected the sale of these partnership interests. And let's just be clear, 1 Jan 2022 is not very far away. There are a number of activities going on in the US, particularly to try and delay the implementation of this. But from a QI standpoint, potentially, for any QIs that deal with these instruments, they have a lot of things to think about in the interim. First of all, to understand where these instruments may exist in their universe, to understand where they're holding them, and to understand the gamut of where withholding tax implications could arise. QIs will then have to decide whether or not they take on any withholding responsibility in respect of these particular interests going forward, or provide information up a chain to a US broker. And finally, I suppose the big question is, if there is a significant amount of business or a specific amount of interest in these partnerships, which could create quite a significant compliance cost in order to comply with these new rules, the question of whether or not to divest or seek alternative investments for clients is something that people will start or are starting to think about. So whilst there is potential deferral of the timeframe of this coming in 2022 and possible changes to the QI agreement itself that need to be announced by the IRS in the course of the next 6 months, in the interim, first of all, getting a handle on where these partnership interests arise is going to be key. So apologies, I had to rush through that very quickly at the end, but certainly more than happy to spend some time on individually with people going through those changes, if relevant, and just quickly open up to questions. Jasmine.
Yeah, apologies. So we have we're very close to time. So what I suggest is, if you do have any questions for us, please put them on Slido or contact us directly with our contact details here. And we'll be happy to discuss with you the specific kind of fact pattern for you and the queries that you have. Because we are at time, I just wanted to thank everyone who has joined us for our first OpsTax webinar. They will be occurring on a more regular basis. As mentioned earlier as well, these are being recorded, so they will be distributed. The slides and recording will be distributed after this event, so along with any insights and articles of reference. So we'll send those over to you, and off the back of that, again, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to us. So just at the end, just wanted to thank again everyone for joining us on our virtual event, wishing you and your families well. Thank you and goodbye.